I've been a part of this congregation for over 5 years. And there are a few people in here in this church that when they walk in the door for the very first time, I notice that they have this presence that is absolutely magnanimous. It's as big as this church building itself. And when I met this lady 2 years ago, in 2015, I was captivated by her presence. And when I say the word flawless, this woman was indeed flawless. She came in with a hat.
Yes, ma'am.
That rivaled Miss Stella.
Oh!
She had on black with high heels for days. She had makeup on and looked absolutely brilliant. I didn't know who this woman was. I was friendly to her, as I should be, as per my job. No, I'm not. Don't worry, that's not. But I didn't think anything about it until August, when my Robert, who you just saw, was at this pageant in August, that same year, at the Miss Florida FI pageant, where I saw this very same woman. Little did I know that she was not just a wonderful magnanimous presence, but she was also a pageant winner. She was a title holder.
Yes.
She had captivated millions by her smile and by her beautiful presence. And we were so lucky, lucky to have her in our congregation today. So will you please welcome to the stage the incomparable Ms. Heather Fontaine.
Yes, ma'am.
Where I lived as a girl. And
I did Marilyn Monroe impersonation. So that got me in a lot of doors. And then Atlanta.
Woo!
Oh
my God!
I'm the better team in that picture. Yeah.
Are you gonna do a Marilyn number four this year?
Oh my man! Even in Atlanta, there was Buford Highway. You could live on Buford Highway and you could live near Piedmont Park because back then everything was all run down. But there were certain areas that you just didn't go to or they would kill you. I remember one time after a pageant, all this commotion and people running around, and the waitress, we were at a restaurant, and the waitress came over and said, you know, I don't have anything against you people, but y'all need to get out of here. Well, these rednecks had gone in their car and got baseball bats and were beating the, you know, because you had to go to the boys' bathroom. And they went in there and started beating the queens up. And that, I'm sure a lot of y'all remember when, you know, when things were like that. And then, what's that, about AIDS?
Well, first of all, you were not just, you moved to Atlanta to Los Angeles, correct?
No, I got hired by this show and we traveled all over the country.
What was that group called?
Prince Dresden. We worked in straight dinner theaters and supper clubs. We worked the Playboy Club in 1977.
Wow. Did you just say the Playboy
in Dallas?
Club?
Yeah, Playboy Club.
In church.
I wasn't a bunny.
No, not a bunny.
No, ma'am. But they had pantyhose that didn't run. They made their own pantyhose, and I just had to share them. Yeah.
This is the best shirt.
But to be in that show, I had to go back to living as a boy. So I did that for about almost 2 years, and I just couldn't do it anymore. I had to live as a woman.
Yeah,
I mean,
come on.
I had to be, and it was, I didn't even say I had to live as a woman. I had to live as myself. You know, trying to get hormones and doctors and hateful, Mary. So then after that, I went and came back to Florida because my mom lived down here. And then there was a movie that they were doing about transgender people in Los Angeles. So I sent my picture and I got approved to be auditioned for the movie. So I went out there, and you would think that LA would be a very open-minded, you know, progressive thinking, and it was not. The gay bars, I had a friend, and we went to a bar in what they call Boys Town in Santa Monica Boulevard, and they asked him for 5 pieces of picture ID. Because he was black. And I thought, I mean, this is a gay bar. And then I wasn't allowed in at all because I was in drag. And they had a sign that said, no sweaters, no cologne, no drag, but 5 pieces of picture ID. I just couldn't believe it, that it would be, so prejudiced like that. So then, after that, you're gonna have to help me along here.
So after you were, well, I'll do what I can. I'm gonna report today, you know.
Okay.
You've already upstaged me, so that's all right. It's hard to do, but you did. So Heather, you actually were on the tour of French Dressing for a while, touring for all these different clubs, including the Playboy Club. And then, did Gary Collins come ask you about the show, or did his producers?
In 1981, I was working at this bar called the Queen Mary, which was a very famous bar back in the day. It was mainly straight people that came in to see the show. But we got contacted by Gary Collins. Y'all know, okay. He had a talk show called Our Magazine. And he wanted the very first preoperative transsexuals to do a talk show. So we were the very first transsexuals to ever do a talk show. And from that opened a lot of doors.
Well, you know, we have that clip.
Yeah!
So if y'all don't mind, can we roll that clip?
Oh, well, there it is.
There it is right there.
That's me.
Grief and a and a lot of laws around HIV and AIDS. Would you, do you have any comment on that?
Well, I got concerned, and this was around 1981 when, TMI, but I used to use poppers a lot. And they said that would give you the gay cancer. So I thought, oh, I'm gone. We had like 5-6 male dancers that were all gay that were in the show. And I was like, you know, because they were saying sweat and tears and all this stuff. And I got very concerned about it because these were my friends. I couldn't be ignorant, you know. So one of the queens in the show was writing a book about HIV. And so I was asking her questions. Well, in San Francisco, Long Beach, and New York, they were starting a trial HIV test. And they wanted different representatives from different parts, you know, like leather guys and all this. Well, me and my roommate got selected to be the transgender or transsexuals at that time. And when tests first started, they were just doing a trial. So they interviewed you for like an hour before you took the test. Then you took the test, and it was a month later that you went back and got your results, and then they counseled you again. And they wanted us to be very specific as far as what we did sexually and all of that, because this is how they were going to find out,
right,
you know, how it was spreading. So I felt very fortunate that me and my roommate both were chosen to be the transgender or transsexual part of their trial. Then when AIDS happened, and the trans community was hit so hard, because a lot of girls weren't as fortunate of being able to do shows for a living. You know, they were having to work the streets. And it was either that or be homeless, you know. So a lot of them started dying. Well, in the hospital, they had two wards, big, huge rooms, one for men, one for women. They put the trans girls, even the sex changes, in with the men. And I don't know if y'all saw Terms of Endearment, Give My Daughter the Shot. I went nuts on those people. Because I said, why do you disrespect them when they lie dying? And they said, well, they never had their paperwork changed. And I said, what difference does it make? They're not going to get up in the middle of the night and rape some woman. It was crazy. And even the boys that we knew, the discrimination as far as even living somewhere, if they knew you were had AIDS. Because the medicine back then was not like it is now. You could tell. And, you know, usually they died a lot from the medications itself. But yeah, it was. I'm sure a lot of y'all remember what AIDS was like when it first started.
It was not easy.
No. And like I said, the trans community got hit very, very hard.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because you made a comment during that time when there was rampant discrimination, as there is now, right? That you only had two options. You could either perform at various clubs and various scenes and various places, or you are left to walk the streets.
Right.
Or be a part of the sex work.
Mm-hmm.
And you stayed away from that piece, correct?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Good. So what inspired you to be in the pageant world? What inspired you to be in the club world to be a performer?
Well, for a lot of them, I entered because, well, the money was good. If you won, you know, you'd get a good prize, and you got to travel. It was a lot of fun. But when I entered Miss Florida, Miss Florida is considered a national title. not just a state title. You can get booked all over the country by being Miss Florida. Is that prestigious? Well, I had gone to see Sunset Boulevard with Glenn Close in L.A. And when I came, y'all familiar with Sunset Boulevard? Okay. I had gone to see the play, and I was on the edge of my seat. It was just the most incredible thing. So I said, I'm going to go in on Miss Florida. I moved to Florida and everything so I could do that stage production. But we have the props, the car, it's a huge stage. And like the sets would turn around and just a full cast of people for a 7-minute number. But anyway, I ended up going out. And it was, of all the things as far as titles, the being Miss Florida was the highest point for me. Because I'm from, you know.
So we're running short on time, but being that we're in a church.
Okay.
Right. How has your faith played into all this? And we'll wrap up with this question. So how has your faith been a part of this? I mean, this is a beautiful picture as well. One of my favorite, actually. So how has your faith been involved in every single bit and piece of your life? Can you explain that a little bit?
Okay. I was cast, well, I don't know what I am now. Going here, I mean, this is it for me. But I guess I was Catholic, recovering. I'm just kidding. Well, it's a hard road.
It is a hard road. Catholic and Baptist, we got over it.
Yeah. Well, I have a priest that, you know, I was an altar boy and everything. I mean, I was very, very religious as a child, more so than anybody in my family. Well, I had quit going to church and had started living as a woman. And my godmother called me and asked me to come over, and when she opened the door, she goes, oh, this is why you're not coming to church. I was dressed like a girl. And she said, well, Father O'Hara's on his way over here, and I like to have died. Because I didn't know what, you know, I didn't want to be, because it was in my soul to live as a woman.
Come on.
You know, I mean, it wasn't, whoever said this is something you choose is very ill-informed. being gay, being trans, being lesbian, whatever. Choose it. I mean, not that it's not wonderful. So anyway, Father O'Hara comes over and he comes in and he goes, oh, you know, same thing. So I told him, you know, how I felt and all that. He had known me since I was like 8 years old, 8, 9, you know. And he said, knowing you the way I do, because I was a good kid, he said, how can I condemn you? He was a young priest, too. He said, how can I condemn you knowing you the way that I do and knowing what's in your heart? So he changed my baptismal records, my confirmation, everything to female.
Wow.
I can't say that kept my faith, because I would have still had my love for God in my heart and soul, even if he didn't accept it. But by him accepting it, it made me grow as a human being in a whole another way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I really did. And I continued going to the Catholic Church. You know, I just wouldn't be involved and wouldn't make friends. You know, I didn't want to do all that, because if they found out, I didn't want to go through all that. When I walked through these doors, I have never felt so welcome in my whole life. I just love y'all to death. And that's why, I mean, I can't. My husband wanted to move up to North Florida, and I'm like, they don't have the church there. I'm not going nowhere. But anyway, that's my story.
Well, Heather, I am so excited to be here on stage with you. It's always an honor. And thank you so much for your life and for your continual love and just for being who you are. You are definitely a shining light for the entire community, and I am so grateful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Got me paired up over here.